Crackdown 3. You got to play this game at an event recently?
I did. Microsoft had an event to... I feel like this is not the first time they've let people play Crackdown, but it's the first time in a while.
Yeah, I feel like we've been waiting for Microsoft to make a big push, because it seems like all their messaging about Crackdown 3 has been a trailer with a dabble of Terry Crews and some Phil Spencer apologies of like, it'll come out all right. Yeah, no. They're prepping it in a very under-the-radar way.
I think I played it briefly in 2017, and I was talking to Cork this morning, and he played it at Gamescom a couple years ago.
Okay.
So that was like, it has been a while, for sure.
And now you got to play how much of it?
I got to play about an hour of multiplayer and an hour of the campaign.
Okay.
From the beginning of the campaign or just kind of plopped in the middle?
I plopped in the middle.
Okay.
With a stat or with a cop that has some stats that you can actually play around with.
Nice.
Okay. And the big takeaway was the high level takeaway?
It feels like Crackdown.
And that's a
good thing.
That is a complicated thing, but it's better than I came in with.
Cool.
Yeah, we recorded an episode of New Gameplay today if you want to see even more gameplay footage for Crackdown 3. But sitting in on that, like the big takeaway I had is like it looks older than I expected. Mm-hmm. And it looks, you know, it's got a little jank around the edges there. But at the same time, it still kind of looks fun.
Yeah, I that's pretty much how I felt. Like it's like, oh, this is clearly not the evolution of open world games that... I don't even want to say Crackdown 1 was, but it is Crackdown 1. It is, they skipped over Crackdown 2 and went, okay, we're just going to make that game again, but a bit more modern and a bit more tightly controlled.
And plus, you said the four magic words that the developers referenced that Kyle Hilliard would be very into, Imran, which you recall is talking about the game structure.
Breath of the Wild?
Yeah!
Oh, okay, I like this game.
So what did they say exactly?
I only got that because of you said Kyle.
What are the developers?
It's my middle name,
how did they reference that game?
The exact quote was they were very happy to see Breath of the Wild come out because it meant they were doing the right thing.
Because all the weapons
they were doing
are
the same thing of you can just do whatever you want whenever you want.
Right. So you can go right to the end tower in the beginning if you want to do that.
Right.
Yeah,
it would just be very difficult.
That's cool. Because like it was funny. Leo and I were discussing it and I kind of had this revelation that Crackdown was... Like the original, which I love, was more open-ended than I think I ever gave it credit for because you just are basically given a list of people to kill and you can do it however you want, you know, which is surprisingly open-ended, especially for when it came out. So I'm excited to hear that it sounds like they're going even further with that, with 3.
Yeah, definitely. Like, even just the general bosses. Like, I remember the first Crackdown that I was so stunned that I could take on a boss by like swimming behind his like villa and climbing up and just stomping down into him. This one, it's like there's a boss that you have to draw out. And I was, first time I fought him, I died. And then the second time I came in, I ran a car into him. So like it can still do all that stuff and it still feels incredibly good to do it.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Does it feel a little cheaper than you're expecting in the production budget?
For a game that's been in development, because you hear it like, oh, it's a first-party game that's been in development for 5 years. You think of, like, God of War or The Last of Us or whatever.
Yeah.
It's not that. It is a very... I would say it feels like a AA game like Crackdown 1 did way back when.
Mm.
Yeah, I think you're totally right. I think it's a great way of looking at it. What do you think the reaction's going to be when the game comes out? I know after playing for that limited amount of time, it's tough to predict, but you're a smart man. What do you think people are going to say about Microsoft when that game comes out?
I don't think it's going to set the world on fire. I think there are people who definitely have high expectations of that game, and I'm not sure their expectations are going to be met. Just like I said, it's a first-party exclusive that's been in development for 5 years. But they clearly are aiming to make another Crackdown game and to kind of heal the wounds of Crackdown 2 before they do anything else. Like, I was talking to them, actually, and the first pitch for that game, like, before we ever saw it, was a multiplayer-only game. Like... Not even just co-op or open world or anything, just PvP multiplayer.
How
and
bizarre.
Like eventually they realize this is a terrible idea. No one's gonna want this.
Yeah.
So they made the story and campaign. That's kind of what took 5 years. Is that they kind of kept iterating on it and fixing it and making the game itself better. I think a lot of people are gonna be like, oh, okay, I like Crackdown, but I don't think it's gonna be like game of the year, 10 on 10, whatever. people are expecting of, you know, a Microsoft exclusive in 2019.
It seems to be a notch above this, but it feels like that same audience that's like what we call half this room right now with Leo and Kyle, for the people that liked Agents of Mayhem. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I can see it. It feels better than Agents of Mayhem.
I bet it does. Yeah, I bet the reception will be similar to Darksiders 3. And that there will be people that are like, yeah, it sort of feels like a last gen game, but it's solid and there's fun stuff here. That's my hope and my prediction.
Yeah. I would love to see the budget comparison because I bet it's quite imbalanced, but yeah, it's a weird deal. So you play a lot of single player, fought a boss, all that stuff. You got a fun glitch fighting the boss, which is in our new Gameplay Today episode. Multiplayer looked insane.
Yeah, multiplayer is where the Cloud Engine destructibility stuff is. That's only where it is now. So you have this entire, like, fake virtual city that is entirely destructible except for the floor. So you can, for example, if somebody's on the top of a tower just sniping you out, you can go to the bottom of the tower and just wreck it. So the entire tower will come collapsing down. And it's a very cool thing to see. I don't know how long that's going to be fun, but for the entire like hour I played it, it was pretty fun.
It's insane. They are not subtle about that destruction. All they want to make sure you notice that, hey, everything's falling apart around you at all times here.
How big is that area? Is it like comparable to a city, or is it kind of like a dense little multiplayer map?
It's comparable. I would say maybe like half the size of an island in that game. Okay. So not huge, but like you need to be able to track people and like see them from a distance. And like the multiplayer is lock-on based, which is probably for the better because everyone's jumping around and like dashing through things, and you want to be able to keep an eye on them. But it's like the skill in that game comes from staying off people's radar and destroying the stuff they're standing on.
Sounds cool.
And the game's coming out when?
That game is coming out February 15th.
Weird. On PC as well, right?
Yes.
Of course.
2 weeks from today.
That's so wild. You saw some of the campaign. You said you didn't start from the beginning, but you were kind of in the middle. What is Terry Crews' role? Like, is he an NPC that you interact with?
Marketing guy.
Well, a lot of people think that he's playable. Like, they think he's the protagonist of the game, which he is not, correct?
I know he's playable in multiplayer. I'm not positive about single player. From what I know, so we can't talk about the intro of the game.
Okay.
But there is an intro to the game that does answer story questions.
Okay. Because I guess I'm just, I know it's marketing. He's like,
he's the face
of the commercials.
But he's not integrated. Don't expect him to be the star of this show.
It seems like him and the narrator guy, who I can't remember his name, who runs the agency. It seems like, do they like work together to give you missions or something? Or those are questions you can't answer right now.
So the narrator does give you missions. There's also another woman who gives you missions as well. And she like tells you like the bait. She's a straight man of the group, I guess.
Okay.
The Terry Crews, I occasionally hear like over propaganda speakers in the city talking about how the agency's here to help. So I'm not sure what his role at that point in the game is.
He is functioning in game the same way he is functioning outside of the game, where he's like, hey, we got Terry Crews. Like, it's good, right? You guys. Come
on. You are having a good time. Woo!
Terry Crews is here for Brooklyn Nine-Nine, the yogurt guy.
Yeah, pretty much.
All right.
Be hyped you hear and see Terry Crews occasionally.
That sounds like an interesting game. That was just a clip from a larger show called The Game Informer Show. You can find it on iTunes, Google Play, or GameInformer.com. We take the fun opportunities and exclusive information from Game Informer Magazine and boil it into a show that airs every Thursday with exclusive cover story information, developer interviews, a lot of fun stuff. So come love games with us.